Live from Asbury, it's Sunday morning worship. Welcome to Asbury on our Facebook page this morning. Also, welcome to those who are calling in on through Zoom this morning. Thank you for coming here to worship today, that we get to celebrate the risen Christ. Yes, we are in the season of Easter right now. Easter is not just a day, it's a season, and we get the chance to come together to worship, to celebrate, to give God thanks and praise in worship in a different way. And yes, we're live, and yes, we've got lots of moving parts and challenges of doing it online. So we thank you that you have chosen to come to worship with us today. We are live, and so just having that chance for us all to join at once and feel like a congregation, even though we are in our own separate homes this morning, that we can feel connected through the joy of technology, that you can come together and in the chat comment section, you can welcome people into worship this morning if you see someone you haven't seen in a while or someone new. Share a welcome with them this morning. So thank you for coming to worship with us. So some items to have on hand this morning, a candle if you have one, a rock. We've been talking about rock for the past few weeks after Easter, this symbolizing the stone rolled away from the tomb. We'll talk about that in a moment some more. And if you have food, you can definitely bring it and eat it with us. We'll be saying a blessing just a little bit later, so don't dive into it yet. But that we can eat and consume not only the food that we have, but the Word of God and the presence of God around us. And also to have a chalk or a piece of chalk or a pencil. We'll be doing a blessing with that a little bit later on too. So make sure you have those items on hand. Also, we're going to use Mentimeter to get a survey from people who are participating. So if you could pull up a different tab on your computer or another device, go to menti.com and just have this on hand. Type in code 499360. And there's already a question on there if you want to start thinking about that. What are some gods that you have served other than capital G God, our one and true God? What are some other gods that you have followed or fallen behind or submitted to that might not have been the best thing? So if you go to that page again and enter the code 499360, and it's anonymous, so you can put in your responses and it'll show up anonymously. And then during worship, if you have any prayer requests, you can type them in the comment section, or if you want to post them anonymously, you can go to www.asburyunitedmethodist.org/prayer-wall and post them there. We'll be sharing them before our prayer time later on in worship. So friends, for those who are moms, I just want to say Happy Mother's Day to you. And this has been a different kind of Mother's Day along with other things that we're celebrating. So yes, friends, this Mother's Day will be different. So no dinners out, no big get-togethers, no shopping trips. Moms, you may feel a little anxious, stressed, trapped, overwhelmed by the daily routine, and nervous about the future and what's going to happen. You may feel a little touched out, called upon, offering educational advice too many times. Cleaning the house may be as effective as eating an Oreo during a dentist appointment. You cannot control the situation, but you can control how you respond. You can be a strong woman of God. You can help protect your family. You can be a light in the darkness. And we all want you to know that you are loved. You are appreciated, and you are not alone. You are a beloved daughter of God, intricately and wonderfully made. So happy Mother's Day to all the moms out there today. So we are also selling geraniums this month. This is for Pentecost, and there's more information about this in the bulletin that we posted on our Facebook page and our website. We're doing something a little different. You can buy one and share one, and you can pick them up the day before Pentecost and then have it in your home as we celebrate Pentecost together, and also give the gift of another one to someone who might not be able to make it out so well. So I hope you can join in that fun celebration. And for the month of May, our giving, our collection for the month, this time is going to the Child Advocacy Center. And so far, we've gotten a great amount of donations that have been brought to the office, and we're still collecting. Just a heads up, our office is now going to be open again from Monday to Thursday, usual office times from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. So you can drop them off, you can swing by, say hello from a distance, and drop off those items for the Child Advocacy Center. Those items are also listed in the bulletin. And wanted to celebrate birthdays happening this week, since they will be celebrated a little bit differently this year. So happy birthday to Lisa Thomas, Cadence Rio, Lavender Tosh, Sophia Grover, and Virginia Salvag, who is turning 99 this week. So if you get a chance, connect with her and wish her a special happy birthday this week. So friends, we do it a little bit differently now, but I want to offer you in this place, as we come to worship, the peace of Christ. So may the peace of Christ be with you, and you can respond to the others in the comment section and also with you. So may the peace of Christ be in this place as we prepare for worship. So friends, we've been home for a few weeks, and we'll be for a few more. So why not make a festival out of it? On the United Methodist calendar, it's not only Mother's Day today and celebrating that, but it's the festival of the Christian home. So what a great time to make your home sacred and make memories of a worshipful experience in your dwelling place. So during this time, we'll break bread together, break open scripture, and have a special Zoom call with Kayla Patterson, who defeated COVID-19 through some incredible God experiences and is happy to be reunited with her family at home. And so we'll visit with her a little bit later along, in worship, about her incredible experience. So today we're going to be looking at Joshua, the book of Joshua, chapter 24, and how the people who have been promised by God to live in this promised land, they're about to take their places in their dwellings. And Joshua, before he kind of lets them go into their places, he says, "Now, remember when you were wandering in the desert and you kind of connected with these other gods or things that you worshiped, and you kind of strayed away from God? Well, now that you're about to go back into your home, I want you to remember who you should be following." So as they, before they go into their homes, to remember the God who brought them through. But before all of that, what was the God that they were serving? What were the gods that they were serving? So just taking a moment on Menti to list that, we'll see a little wordle of things that gods we might have served in temptation as we wander through the desert. So realizing that We all have these struggles. So let us begin worship, if you'll join me in prayer. Loving God, we come together to praise you, the source of our life and our hope. We come seeking your compassion, comfort, and peace. We come seeking your protection and guidance. Dwell within us as we dwell within you. Holy Spirit, rest upon us as we rest in you. Bless this time, bless this food, bless this sacred meal, this communion with each other and with you, here, now. Amen. So friends, with this Mother's Day and just living life in this different way, we have these pressures. We have these gods that we want to follow, that the God of judgment or the God of perfection in being a mom, in being a parent, in being a leader in the community. And we feel these pressures, this weight in our lives. And in this time, in this worship space, I want you to just, you know, put that into this stone that you might be holding in your hand, the weight of that, and the weight of those gods that bear down on us. And I want you to let it go. That you don't have to deal with that right now. And light the candle that you have in front of you. A symbol of the light of Christ among us as we come into worship. So friends, I want to give you the assurance that each time that we come to worship, we can let go of those things, let go of the burdens that we have, the sins that we have committed, the faults that we feel that we have, and we can let them go. And God can take care of that. And in letting go of that, we can open our hands and worship freely of a God who chases after us with grace and with forgiveness. And that is how we can come to worship today. So friends, let us, in that freedom, let us sing, "Come Christians, join to sing."
Come Christians, join to sing, Alleluia. Christ our King, Alleluia, Amen. Let all with heart and voice before His throne rejoice. Praise is His gracious choice, Alleluia, Amen. Come, lift your hearts on high, Alleluia. Yeah.
Amen. Alleluia, the shout of joy and praise that we sing during Easter time, that we get to sing that together, even though we are far away in our separate homes, that we can still join together and sing those alleluias. So friends, I wonder if we can put up those mentee results of the gods that we have served, or the gods that we have followed, that we deal with, possessions, career, putting work first. You can still enter in if you're able to. Working, busyness, you know, we've got a couple of that. Money, TV, internet, perfectionism, illicit relationships, what others think, video games, food. Yes, these are all things that we battle with, the demons that we fight against, the gods that distract us from serving a true God. So, knowing that, let us hear those words that Joshua says to the people in the book of Joshua, chapter 24, verse 14 through 15.
Now, therefore, revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord.
So, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. What does that look like? How do we experience that? And especially in this time, how can our house serve the Lord? And what difference does it make? So I have invited Kayla on this Mother's Day and celebrating the Festival of the Christian Home. And I thought it would be powerful for her to share her experience of battling with COVID-19 and the things that happened through that and as a result of that, and then coming back home. So first, I just wanted to share a little background on this. There's a group, an update group that I'm a part of, and usually this group is Kayla updating her all of us on her father's situation and how he's doing. But suddenly, back in March, things flipped, and her mom, Teresa Ballinger, gave us all a report of all of a sudden what happened to Teresa. So Teresa is saying this update. Kayla had her gallbladder removed on March 18th. Spiked a temperature on March 21st, that Saturday. On Monday, the doctors thought it was a surgical infection and put her on antibiotics. Throughout the week, she had nausea, vomiting. But then over the weekend, on Friday, the 27th, she was sent to the ER for a possible blood clot in her lung or pneumonia. Her husband, Sam, had to drop her off at the door and not able to accompany her. And so she was left in the ER. And so let's see if we can connect to Kayla right now. We're doing this via Zoom. I'm hoping
Hi.
Technology will work.
I'm hoping so. I had to move a little bit because it kept disconnecting.
Okay. All right. We're going to do the
can
best.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes. I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. We might have a little delay, but that's okay. So, Kayla, thank you for joining
All
this
right.
morning. We're working with technology here. We're not able to have you in the sanctuary here, so we're doing the best we can. So you're driving around.
Now I'm moving because where I was at on the gravel road was disconnecting. So I'm getting up a little bit higher to get more service.
Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
So I just shared the backgrounds of what happened leading up to that time where you were brought into the hospital and you were separated from your family and brought into the ER. So how was your experience from that point on when you were separated from the ones you loved?
Well, I was in the ER and I at that point did not have a fever when I first checked in, and so they didn't put a mask on me immediately until I got to the back and they realized they were just gonna go ahead and treat it as COVID and take all those precautions just to make sure. But, you know, I am not a fan of having an IV started. I hate needles on myself. I can help anybody else have it done, but I had to have, you know, several swabs done and several tests done and an IV started without anybody around me that I knew. So it was a little scary. But, you know, I kept texting my mom and my husband since that's the best I could do at that point.
Mm-hmm. So while they were apart, you were still able to keep connected there, fortunately. So that's good. So did you have any concerns about COVID-19 before any of this started happening?
I mean, I knew it was a thing, but I honestly was kind of under the assumption that even if I got it, it wouldn't be as bad as it was for some people, because I thought I was, you know, fairly young and fairly healthy. I mean, I have a tendency with my allergies to get upper respiratory infections, so I had basically decided I would probably end up with it at some point. I just didn't know at what point that would be.
Okay, so you came in on Friday and you got diagnosed on Saturday. So how did things happen after that Saturday?
So actually Saturday I woke up and I was like, man, I feel good. Like, I feel so much better. Those antibiotics must have worked last night. Then I didn't sleep at all Saturday night, and Sunday all the way into Monday was probably the roughest 24 hours I've probably ever experienced. It was also very interesting experience because it happened to be when the lake area was praying for the hospital staff that day as well. Sunday I woke up and I still had a fever, and I was struggling beyond belief to breathe. Felt like I was drowning the whole time. That is the day that the ICU doctor, the pulmonologist, was standing outside my room that afternoon, evening, for about 4 hours. I had a respiratory therapist and a nurse standing right in front of me in my room in their full gear, and I was going back and forth between, please don't intubate me, I can't be intubated, I just watched my dad do this a year ago, to do whatever you have to, I can't breathe, I'm going to die. And that went on for a while. Thankfully, every time they bumped up my oxygen, my body decided to work a little bit, and I would catch up a little bit, but I was, I think at that point, a little too stressed to be able to take a big breath anyways. But finally Monday I kind of evened out, but I was still on 8 liters of high flow oxygen. And Tuesday they slowly started weaning it down, but it was only at 6 liters of high flow. It wasn't until like the overnight hours when I finally started sleeping that they would slowly turn it down and see how I did without knowing that they had turned it down.
All right, hold on. I want to go back to, I think it was Sunday. So things were getting tricky, and something happened outside in the parking lot. What happened there?
So the Christian radio station up here is Spirit FM, and they had put out to everybody on social media that they were going to host a where people could congregate. They could drive in. It was going to be a drive-in prayer time. And they played Waymaker, which is now probably one of my favorite songs, and I get chills every time that it plays. And the parking lot all the way up the grass hill and into the property behind the hospital was filled with cars. I was on the ground floor, so I could see right out my window was everything. I could see everybody driving in. The ambulance had come up and like had their lights on, you know, as people were coming in. There was hospital staff up on the top of the hospital and right in front of my room. They had come out from the ER. But they said they played Waymaker. Everybody was singing along with them. And then they said a big prayer over the entire hospital and the staff and all the work they were doing. I had been freezing, probably from the fever, but I had been freezing in the hospital room, and my room just like filled with warmth, like a hug, like a big hug. And it was just like this warm all over feeling. And that was part of the time where I was struggling really hard to breathe. And after getting up to 8 liters of high flow, I don't even know where my lungs filled with air, because I didn't think it was possible, but it literally felt like God was just filling my lungs with air and I was able to breathe again. And from that point on, it was hard to breathe, but I didn't struggle to get oxygen in like I had been.
That's incredible that you were able to just feel something like a change, just a strong change from one end to the other. Almost instantaneously. So, man, friends, that is the power of prayer. And I know a lot of people at Asbury have been praying for Kayla and strangers that she didn't even know were praying for or helping her get through this. And so that was the result of those prayers. That is incredible.
Yeah.
So, some people say, you know, they just kind of go out in the world and they say, well, you know, God's going to protect me from getting COVID-19. So if that's the case, then, well, where was God when you got COVID-19?
I feel like that God was giving me an opportunity to be able to experience him in his fullest, you know. I mean, there's nothing else when you're looking at the moment of I'm not going to take another breath to all of a sudden you're breathing and you know that there's thousands of people outside your window praying, and you know you've got a team of prayer warriors behind you and all over the United States praying for you, and all of a sudden, you know, you're able to breathe. You know, obviously still supported by the oxygen, but I feel like there's times when God protects us straight up and doesn't allow us to get sick, but there's also times where we need some reminders, his power and power of prayer, and I think it also opened the eyes of a lot of people that know me, and you know, this virus is now real for them. So it's it's affected more than just me.
Yeah, definitely. When we heard that you were diagnosed, you know, it really brought it home. And it's not just something that's far away in a big city, that it comes here too, that you were at Mercy Hospital and somehow picked it up around there. Really brought it home. And just hearing about your experience, I mean, not that God, you know, put a target on you and said, you know, okay, you're going to get this so other people can be warned, but that, you know, God, you've experienced this and we're like, oh, this is real and this can be really bad, but God can help you overcome it in some incredible ways. So we really appreciate you sharing your experience so that we can be more aware as we're trying to overcome this, to keep the curve flat. We've already done a really good job just to keep it coming. So you share with us a few God sightings. So how has your faith changed as a result of this experience? Has it changed?
Maybe deeper. I know that it has, but maybe realize that I'm surrounded by some people that are sharing beliefs, and
Kayla.
Are you still there?
Well, you're breaking up a little bit. Oh, nuts. Oh, trying to get back on.
Okay, are you there?
Yes.
Okay, weird.
Sorry about that.
It's okay. But I just saw, like, people that that have never prayed, that have never had felt like they had a relationship with God, they're all of a sudden talking to me about how much they saw God move and how much they now see the value in praying and what it has done. And I think for me, that's helped my relationship with God to see that, you know, even something awful can lead to so much good.
True. Yes. So has your view of being a mom changed as a result of this experience? Now, I saw on Facebook that the first picture you posted when you got out of the hospital was a picture of you and Raylan, you know, together again. So how has that changed things, this experience changed things?
The hospital forced me to...
Wait, hold on. we got to get you in a better connection here. I know you've got some good words to say. What's that?
Hold on, just... Can you hear me?
Yes and no. Try again.
I didn't.
Kayla?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, you're really good when you respond to me, but then you start breaking up. So let's try one more time. I'm sorry.
Okay. I feel like being a mom and being in the ICU,
Nuts. Kayla, it's breaking down. How about we, without video? I appreciate your patience here. I'd love to hear a response too. Let's see what we can do. We may have to take a break and come back to her.
I may have to drive uptown further. Can you hear me?
Yes. The first sentence is good, but then it starts breaking up. So let's try. All right, try now.
Okay.
All right, Kayla, it's getting a little choppy, so how about we take a break for now? There's something else I can do in the meantime. So we'll switch it up a little bit.
Okay.
I'll give you a moment to find a better connection, and we'll try and reconnect, because we're getting to the good part, and I don't want to...
Okay, perfect.
But now you're sounding okay.
I don't know. It's okay. I'll drive uptown.
Okay. Let's take a break. Try to find a better connection, and we'll get back to you in about 5 minutes.
Perfect.
All right. I appreciate the flexibility here. We'll try and get back to her, because I really want to hear what she has to say too. So in the meantime, what we can do is talk about where you have seen God working in your home, that God is present. God is present, can come through the walls of our safe places, that God can connect with Kayla in the hospital when she is not even at home. But seeing your home as a sacred place and inhabited by God too, if you could go to Menti and go to that next question. So how have you seen God working in your home during this time that we have been quarantined to our homes? If you could just share something that you have seen, we'll give you a moment to discuss that in your home, if you have others around you. So we'll give you about a minute to discuss that, and then you can post that up on Menti. All right, giving you a minute to kind of discuss it amongst yourselves at home, but you can go to Menti and you can put in a response. So some responses so far. How have you seen God working within your home? In my grandchildren's wonder. Actually, I was talking about that earlier this week in one of my 3 o'clock devotionals on the Facebook page about having a sense of awe and wonder and holy curiosity, and that's neat how you can see it in your grandchildren's wonder. If we all have the wonder of a child right now through you, Mom. Yes, through all our moms. God's working overtime. So bringing peace in this time of unknown and anxiety, in having more patience and gratitude in this situation. Yes, patience and gratitude indeed. When loved ones are really sick, yet he puts the right people in our path to help. Yes, yes. Especially when loved ones may be in the hospital or in a nursing home or assisted care facility right now, and we're not able to visit them. How God can bring someone who can in their presence and offer words of love and hope. So yes, getting a call or text from someone right when you need that contact. Yes, a beautiful spring color. Patience and time shared. Yes, concern from the family, finding new ways to connect. Time for prayer and Bible study, more family time and time outside in two blades of grass that formed a cross. Yes, yes. How we can have those little God sightings in the midst of our day, just to notice little things like that. God has been watching over the Gladsons, taking care of Jack each time he accidentally falls. He has not been seriously injured. Amen. Amen. So God has been working in some incredible ways. So let's see if we can get back to Kayla. Let's see if she's got a better connection now. I don't see a picture of her. Kayla, are you there?
Yeah, I unmuted the volume, but I haven't turned the video back on.
Okay, that's, well, at least we got you talking, so we'll see what we can do. Okay, now back to that question, how has your relationship with your child changed at all in being a mom and being a parent through this experience?
Okay, so did you guys hear any of what I said?
Not really, unfortunately.
Okay. Can you guys hear me now?
Yes, pretty well.
Okay. So it was very hard to start out with because I didn't want to be impatient, because I didn't want to have to be separated from my family, and especially Raylan. However, once I was admitted to the ICU, I saw the value in being separated from him for a longer period of time to ensure that he did not have to experience what I had experienced. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, when I came home and he's jumping up and down, because he was asleep in the car the whole time on the drive home. So he didn't even know I was in the car until we got home.
Oh.
So he was very, very, very excited to see mommy. And, you know, we still had to be cautious of him crawling all over my stomach and everything, because, but, you know, he was able to get right next to me and cuddle with me, and which he hadn't even been able to do for the week and a half before that, because I was in so much pain, so.
That's good. So you kind of had a homecoming at home.
Yes.
Like the joy just happened at home when he woke up. That's pretty special. But
yeah.
So there's this also this concern for safety as well. You wanted to keep him safe throughout all of this.
Yeah.
So how does that transfer then in taking him outside now? How concerned are you about just going outside the house now?
Taking him in public.
Yeah.
I mean, I wear a mask when I go out in public, but I have not taken Raylan out in public. We go outside at our house, and we go to the farm, and he plays outside and can run as freely as he wants to run. So,
yes.
I definitely think there's still a lot of caution that I use, especially with Raylan. But just in general, I think it's safer to, you know, be a bit more cautious than some are choosing to be, just because I don't know what other, besides COVID, what potentially I could get sick from, so.
That's true. That's true. Okay. So how has your relationship changed at all with your mom as a result of this experience? So like I said earlier, before we started, so you were kind of keeping everyone up to date about your dad within this group text chat, and then all of a sudden things changed and your mom came in and she started sharing what's happening about you. So how has your relation changed, if it has, as a result of this experience?
I feel like for my mom and I, there's been a lot of things that have maybe changed our relationship as time has gone on. Just, you know, different things from having, when I had my knee surgery and I couldn't walk, I couldn't, you know, take care of myself, to even seeing her incredible strength through this whole situation with my dad. There's been a lot of things that's already strengthened our relationship. But I think the most impactful from the experience of being in the hospital was just the her wanting to be as strong as possible for me, but me being able to see fear and terror on her face, because I would video call her and Sam every day. I think it's the only way besides prayers I made it through not having family around me. But on Sunday when I was leaned back in the bed gasping for air and she was like, honey, you just need to rest. It's going to be okay. But I could see the worry on her face. I think that kind of opened my eyes to the, you know, always ongoing kind of worry that moms have and love that they have for their kids that you just don't really understand until you're there.
Yes. So she doesn't have to be the perfect and everything's fine all the time mom. It's kind of okay to see her in a vulnerable place.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, I feel like for me, especially as a mom now, it makes life real. I worry about my own kid, which I worry a lot, but I worry about my own kid, but to see that same worry on her face made me go, oh, this is part of being a mom. This is how things go, you know, like she's still a role model, even though I think, you know, even for me as a mom, it's like, okay, put on a happy face. Don't let them know that you don't feel good. Don't, you know, even at 32 years old, my mom is still doing so. But it was real. It made it that much more, I think, impressive for what she's been through in 32 years of being my mom and how strong she still is.
Yeah. Yep. That's great that you noticed that in her. So today for worship, we're looking at Joshua 24, verses 14 and 15. So Joshua explains how people have the option to follow and serve many types of gods, but Joshua chooses to serve the Lord. So how has your choice to serve the Lord made this experience any different?
I feel like I was thinking about this, even getting ready for this. I don't know that it's made it any different than what it would have been, but I feel like it gave more purpose to what I was experiencing. I wasn't, even though it felt like I was alone, I wasn't alone. And I knew that there was a reason why I was experiencing the things that I was experiencing, even if I didn't want to be experiencing those things when I was. So I think my choice in, you know, choosing to serve God has also made it a little easier to talk about the things that I experienced while I was in the hospital, because those aren't things that anyone else understands. They weren't there with me. So I think it's kind of made that easier too, and it's made it to the point where I can share God in a different way with people.
Okay. So these things you felt could have still happened, but you wouldn't necessarily, I mean, well, that you could attribute it to God working.
Yeah.
Okay, so that you can pinpoint it. Like what was said earlier, I don't know if you caught any of that, people sharing where they have seen God. Two blades of grass, you know, forming a cross. Now, to someone else, it just might be two blades of grass. But, you know, as a follower of Christ, to see that, you can understand the symbolism of that, and it's helpful to you. So throughout this whole experience, it kind of bolstered your faith.
Yeah, and I feel like a lot of people may not know, but the hospital up here hasn't had the best reputation. In fact, the first thing I was told when I moved up here was, don't go to the hospital unless you're already dead. So when Sam made the decision that I was going to go to Lake Regional instead of driving me to either Lebanon or Springfield to go to Mercy, I said a very long prayer on the way to the hospital that it was going to be okay. And from the second I got there to the second I left, it was obvious that I was in the place that I needed to be. And that God had put certain people there that I didn't even know worked there or didn't even know had a connection there. People that I worked with at Camdenton several years ago sent me e-cards. You know, it was just little pieces that I would not necessarily have gotten other places. So.
Oh, neat. That is special. Oh. God was working that whole time. Oh.
Yes,
that's
he
neat.
Was.
So, my last question for you. So, do you see your home? Well, actually, I got two more, but do you see your home any differently now as a result of this?
I feel like I see more value in my home. I don't know. I don't know if this sounds bad, but before I was taking Raylan to daycare. I was going to work. I would either teach after work or go pick Raylan up. We'd get home late. We'd make dinner. We'd have about an hour together. I'd put Raylan to bed and go to bed. My house was mainly for me to sleep in and get ready in and, you know, go about my day. Mm-hmm. Now I do all of those things in my house. And I think that you just see, for me at least, I've been able to see more value. That my house is a place that I can work and take care of my child and, you know, still have a place for him to sleep and a clean space for him to be at and all of those things.
True.
I used house for all of those things before to see value in it now. I was telling Sam, I was like, you know, I used to dread coming home and knowing I had all these chores to do to, you know, keep up with my house and not being able to spend time with Raylan. And now I'm like, I get to do these things. Mm. You know, there was a week where I didn't know if I was going to get to do those things. So now I see that, you know, I get to do our laundry. I have a kid that I still get to interact with and I still get to clean up his messes and everything else every day. But, you know, an attitude of gratitude has definitely come out of it that I didn't see the value in my house before. Now it's definitely much stronger.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you get to do those things. That's a excellent way. That's an excellent perspective to see your house. You get to be in that place, surrounded by those people. It's not something you should take for granted. So, all right, I'm going to have to wrap up this time. We have a couple more things in worship, but thank you. Thank you for your sharing your experience and what you have gone through and being able to give us encouragement in how God is still active and working today and has done some incredible things for you and will continue to do through you.
Yes, ma'am.
It is incredible. So thank you, Kayla. Enjoy your Mother's Day. Have a great Mother's Day.
You as well. Thank you.
Okay. All right, friends. That is a powerful story. And I don't know about you, but it gives me goosebumps just hearing about the ways she has experienced God working in so many different ways and how God has helped her to overcome this diagnosis and just live in an incredible way now and be at home with her family for Mother's Day. It is much more powerful probably this year than last year. So friends, I'm glad we were able to have that discussion of how you see God working in your home. And just having a different view that we get to be in our homes and we get to serve a God who is constantly present in our homes is an incredible thing. So now, friends, we come to a time of prayer, a prayerful response to what we have heard, what we have experienced. And I'd like to give you an opportunity to share any prayer requests that you have or any joys that you have that we can lift up together in prayer. So please list them now in the comments below or on our website. So what are the prayer requests for today?
We've had a lot of praise and thank yous to Kayla for sharing her story. And the AVs have thanked Teresa for the phone prayer and sharing their strength because after that improvement with their son, who's still in the hospital up in Kansas City. So that's all at this time.
All right. I'd like to also point out those who are listed on the prayer list and the bulletin and to keep all of those specific names in prayer and all the prayers that we have on our hearts that we can lift them up now. So let us pray. Loving God, we have found this place we call home, a place where faith can hold us and grace can renew us, where forgiveness longs for us to be who you will us to be. We have found this place called home, where we can be accepted as we are, where we are welcome in and loved unconditionally as you love us. A place we call home, where we belong and our souls fit, and our questions are allowed and our anger is heard, and our needs are recognized, and our pain is held, and our names are known. But sometimes that doesn't always work out so perfectly, and we pray for your grace to invade our space until it does. We pray for those homes where there is danger, violence, fear, loneliness, hurtful words, and unceasing activity without reason. We pray for those who are sick or are in need of healing. We pray for those who are in hospitals or care facilities far separated from loved ones at home. For your presence is there when we cannot be. We remember those who do not have a place to rest their head. We lift up those whose home is not safe. We pray for those who are far away from home. May you take up residence in them and build a sanctuary of safety, security, and peace. We pray for children, youth, and adults. We pray for parents, step-parents, and foster parents. We pray for couples. We pray for those who are alone. We pray for those who have formed families from friendship. May your grace be present to all. We use to reserve a special place for your presence to be worshiped and felt here in this sanctuary. But now we find comfort that you dwell with us even here, even in these homes. People can gather in the name, in Christ's name in church. People can gather in Christ's name, we realize, also at home. This home, where our place is your place, where you strengthen the bonds between us. May we make this place that welcomes others as much as we welcome you, as a place of grace-filled sanctuary. You knock at the door, ready to come in. Dwell within us as we say this prayer that you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So we're running a little late on things because of our technical difficulties. We'll save Bob's song of Cornerstone. Maybe we'll play that next week for you. It sounded really good when he was practicing earlier. So join us next week so we can sing that together. But now we come to a time of offering in response to the ways God has worked in our world and the worlds of so many other people. The ways that you can give back. You can go to asburyunitedmethodist.org/give, or you can mail in your gift to 1500 South Campbell Avenue in Springfield, or if you're a little concerned about sending something through the mail, you can call us at the office and we can come pick up your gift. One way I have seen people give back in the world today, I noticed one of our parishioners, Kim Dilley, who is in our choir, she was giving back. There are a lot of schools celebrating graduation this past weekend, and she is a teacher in Republic, and I found out that the students were doing a parade, I think over 300 students, and so the teachers and other supporters were in the parking lot, and so she sat there with the sign for 4 hours, I think, just celebrating and cheering the students. So thank you, Kim, and to others who are trying to make this graduation year special. We all know the experiences of graduation, the adults who have graduated, and she's able to just make it a special time so that we can try and do that, that we can give back the blessings that we have experienced to others. So thank you, Kim, for doing that. You might see her on the news this evening. She was caught on there. So friends, these are the gifts that we received during the week as gifts that were mailed in. So if you can join me as we sing the doxology.
God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Since we're running a little late here, I was going to do a house blessing with you, but unfortunately we're running a little late, and I think I'll do that for the 3 o'clock devotional time. So have your chalk or pencil handy for that time, and we're gonna mark our houses, mark our spaces, our places, that this was a special moment in the history of God working in our world, that we can kind of mark our homes as a blessing. So in the future, when we kind of go back to normal, whatever that is, that we can remember this time and how God has worked through this time. So I hope you'll be able to join me at 3 o'clock on Facebook Live. So friends, let us sing this last hymn together. God be with you till we meet again.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsels guide uphold you. With his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again.
Till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet.
God be with you.
So God, our Creator, has built this house that you dwell in. So dwell in security. Christ is knocking at your door, ready to take residence. Welcome him in. The Holy Spirit is among you. So live joyfully. Amen.